I think I know everybody here. You know me. I am the hospital director, but I'm also boarded in infectious diseases. And we're actually going to... The plan has been to start up an ID clinic here and do some ID things, but we have to get the hospital's thing rolling properly. So I've, as an infectious disease specialist, I know a fair amount about biological warfare. Back in the 90s, I was on the state group to help coordinate this after things got so exciting about, you know, anthrax, and we worried about this and that, and 9/11 and so forth. And I have friends that actually are involved in this, ID friends involved in this industry, involved in this research. So I've got a lot of slides. This talk I've given a number of times, it's gone through a variety of revisions and a lot of slides. I'll kind of go fast, but please interrupt. Just holler or raise your hand or whatever if you want to make a comment or ask a question. Let me see if I can do this properly. Okay. So, biological warfare, you know, sort of, it's not really so much a new topic anymore, but in medicine, it's relatively new, right? Because we've seen everything in medicine. And the topic really got to be a big issue in the 60s after we and other countries have done a fair amount of biological warfare experimentation and discovered that it's has terrific capacity to, you know, do harm and to function as a significant weapon. But in particular, after 9/11 and the whole anthrax scare and everything, it's really been at the top of the news. Now, I'll talk a little bit about treaty definition in a slide subsequent to that. There is a treaty, and there are some sort of sub-treaties, and keeps getting revisited. It's not a particularly satisfactory treaty, and so that's why every year they have an updated conference on the treaty and they get the countries together, but it's messy, it's not real clean, and there's some concerns there. And the nice thing about a treaty is that you'd like a treaty that says, okay, we're not doing this. Everybody agree? I agree. This treaty's not like that. It's sort of like, well, be nice, and you know, we don't want to do this, and try not to do that. So a lot of people think it's not a particularly tight and satisfying treaty. So it's not new. This is the most interesting part to me of the talk. Biological warfare has been around forever in terms of recorded human history, and we'll talk about some of that. So, I went to this, you know, I go frequently to the Infectious Disease Society of America, 1998, we all showed up, and we thought the keynote speech was gonna be on one topic, it had been changed, it was on biological warfare. Now, that's a while ago, 1998, so we're used to hearing about meningitis and endocarditis and, you know, resistant bugs. So it was kind of a surprise that the keynote speaker was like biology, and we're looking at each other like, what is this all about? And the thrust was biological warfare because of political concerns over the past 20 years or so. But it was a big surprise. And then D.A. Henderson, David Henderson from Johns Hopkins and from the NIH, gave a talk and made a statement to all of us like, well, you're infectious disease people, you're in the forefront of this, and in your career and your lifetime, you are going to see some manifestation or threat of biological warfare. And we're all like, whoa, how can you say that? So there was a lot of alerting, a lot of attention paid to the threat of biological warfare. And now, there is a lot of attention paid, a lot of work has been done. So, and I'm gonna go over some terms, learn a few things here. This is fun because it's a gross topic, but it's also kind of fun because there's a lot of history in it. Terms like weaponization, fomite, simulant, bioaerosol, biowarhead, and some of these things. Have you ever heard of the 8-ball in Maryland? Have you ever heard of CAFA? It's in the Crimea. And hot zones, Unit 7. Anybody heard of Unit 731? We'll talk about that. So the warfare treaty, just to let you know, this was called the Biological Warfare Conference, started in 1969. Now, this is Nixon, right? Anyway, we had done a lot of research after World War II on biological warfare because, you know, it was attempted during World War II and there were concerns. So we wanted to be not, I think we were genuinely not wanting to use it offensively, but like if other people have this weapon, you better learn about it. So based on the information and the data gained from some of these studies done in like the Johnston atolls in the Pacific Ocean where we did a lot of experimentation. It was very impressive what biological warfare could create, what it could do, the capacity. So the Americans got very nervous appropriately and said, boy, we'd better get with the Soviets and everybody else and let's get this under control so we don't run into problems. So the first treaty started to be worked on in 1969, became finalized or enforced in 1975. About 160 states are involved. That means they're discussing. They're involved in the discussions like we should do this or we should do that or watch out for this. And they're really, it varies from time to time, but really 12 signatories. In other words, countries that say, okay, I'm going to sign here saying I agree with the treaty, I'll abide by what the treaty says. But again, the treaty doesn't say, it's not an absolute treaty, which creates a problem. And there have been multiple review conferences called, about eight. And why do you call these review conferences on the treaty? Because it's not that good a treaty, right? So let's get together again and discuss it more because it's got a lot of loopholes in it. Well, that's happened eight times, the most recent one being in 2016. So much for the treaty. Now, let's talk about this slide. This is from 1997. So it's out of date, but it's not really out of date because this doesn't change. Worldwide, what causes death? You know, there's some unusual, you know, maternal causes, respiratory, cancer. We always think about heart disease and cancer in this country. But worldwide, infectious and parasitic diseases cause the largest share of death worldwide, right? A lot of malaria, a lot of childhood diarrhea, dehydration, and so forth. So one thing this tells us is that organisms replicate, and they get around, and they're ubiquitous. And so if you think about a weapon that can be used, you know, there's no heart disease weapon, there's no kind of cancer weapon, but there are weapons that relate to infectious disorders. Now, and we're learning more and more about infectious disorders, and we thought we knew all the bugs and viruses, but the list keeps growing, right? Because technology gets better, we're discovering new things. And they're called, it's called, the concept is called emerging infections, right? Now we just had a brand new one, right? I mean, we had SARS a number of years ago and some of these other things. What did we just, we just had Zika. Zika actually has been around, but at least we figured out what it is and figured out how it works. So we're constantly coming up with new bugs, and it won't reassure you to know that as these things become emerging, you know, as these emerge, new things emerge, in addition to the old biological weapons, countries and people are going, hey, that's got potential as a biological weapon. That's a little bothersome. So let's talk about some definitions. Weaponization. These South American Aboriginal tribes is an example. To weaponize a weapon, I mean, to weaponize something, that means you take it and you turn it into a weapon. So these frogs that have toxin on their skin, right, that are very poisonous, some of these tribes will take that skin and rub the stuff on their arrows and shoot somebody and kill them or harm them. Weaponization, right? So if I take anthrax, anthrax just sitting there isn't going to do anything, but if I take anthrax spores and package them up into a bomb and drop a bomb on somebody where it explodes and suddenly there's spores all over the place, and then you add humidity and moisture and warmth and the spores sporulate, you get real live anthrax. So you weaponize something. You take it and you turn it into a weapon. Fairly straightforward concept. Weaponization, another example, the KGB umbrella gun, you heard about that in the 60s and 70s. Ricin comes from some plant, castor bean.
It's castor.
Ricin comes from castor bean, highly poisonous. So the KGB had this thing they called the umbrella gun, and they would have it had a little puncture deal on the end, and you'd be a secret assassin on the subway. And the end of your deal, you had a little trigger thing, and the end of your deal is a little ricin thing, and I can accidentally bump up against you or poke you in the leg, and it injects a little bit of ricin, and then whether it's an hour or a day or something later, fairly soon, you die from ricin, but nobody knew what happened. Fomite. A fomite is anything that will carry or transmit, usually an inanimate object, carry or transmit an infectious agent. So, and it can be a person or a stick, like in Vietnam, you know, the Viet Cong took these punji sticks and they smeared them in stool and put them in pits and covered the pits so the soldiers would fall in the pit, and the punji sticks would stab them and they get all kinds of nasty organisms. So the sticks acted as a fomite. If I have adenovirus or rhinovirus as a cold manifestation, and I wipe my nose and I loan it to you, or you pick it up and you wipe your nose, that's a fomite. The handkerchief is a fomite, can carry. Now, this is fun and interesting, simulant. So, we all think we're smarter than we are. Is that correct? So in the 60s, when we and other countries were doing experimentation on biological weapons, most of it secret, all of it secret, we said, well, we're not going to do experiments on anthrax, because that's dangerous, right? And we're not going to do experiments on plague, because that's dangerous. So we came up with, the ID people and the microbiologists came up with a simulant. Simulant means, let's pick an organism that's like plague, but won't hurt anybody, and then we can experiment with it. So for instance, anthrax is Bacillus anthracis, highly lethal. But Bacillus subtilis, S-U-B-T-I-L-I-S, which I've worked with, Bacillus subtilis is just another bacillus. But chemically and structurally and genetically, it's closely related to anthrax. So let's experiment with Bacillus subtilis and see what we can learn about the use of anthrax. Okay? Another example, plague, is a gram-negative organism, Yersinia pestis. Well, you can use other gram-negatives, like maybe E. coli and some other things. And they'll kind of act like the plague organism would react. So we maybe can do some experiments, maybe with some people and animals, normal volunteers, and spray it around and see who gets sick or who gets colonized and who doesn't. So use simulants, but be careful what you wish for. These are microorganisms, and we'll talk more about that. Non-conventional weapons, these are now called WMDs, weapons of mass destruction. Conventional weapon is a bullet, an arrow, a bomb, a tank. Non-conventional weapons of mass destruction, nuclear, chemical, biological, we're focusing here. Bioweapons, guess what? What do you think is the cheapest of these to use? Biological. What do you think is effective? You think it's effective? In the right hands, it can be very effective. You think it's easy to hide? Super easy to hide, right? It's hard to get fissionable material and hide it. It sets off your little things. Chemical requires actually a lot of sophistication. Easier to detect. I can have a little vial of bad news bugs in my pocket, right? I can stick it in my freezer. You can get some spores in a little teeny weeny thing and then grow them up. You can't grow up nuclear weapons. You gotta have them, you know, a bunch of fissionable material. A lot of technology. You can't grow up chemical weapons, you gotta make them. But all I need is a mom and dad bacteria, and I can make other little bacteria and grow whatever I want so I can move it around. So chemical weapons, they're expensive and they have limited use. You drop it on the target and it does its thing, right? Damages people, kills people, harms people, maybe floats around in the air, but it doesn't reproduce. It doesn't reproduce, and it's expensive, and it's hard to do. You got to keep the stockpiles around. Strategic and tactical. Tactical means a weapon that can be used in a battlefield setting, a limited battlefield setting, all right? Let's say Montana went to war against Wyoming, okay? I know it would win, Wyoming would win, but
way more guns.
Yeah, way more guns. We're no nonsense, right?
Less people, but more guns than people. Yeah.
We could go on and on about this, couldn't we? Anyway, a tactical weapon would be a weapon that affects an area, like a battlefield area. It's not going to jump continents, not go over here, and not going to spread outside the battlefield area. Tactical. That means right here, I'm having a battle, I'm going to use a tactical weapon. Tactical weapon. Strategic. What's that mean? That means like global, like far-reaching strategic weapons. So out of these weapons of mass destruction, now people will argue about this, but there are two types of strategic weapons. One is nuclear. What do you think the other one is? It's not chemical, it's biological. Because these are organisms, they can replicate, they can spread, so they can move outside the tactical area. So theoretically, some people class them as strategic weapons. Weapons cost. Now, he's a general. You're going to have to get a haircut before you become a general. At least in the United States military. Weapons cost to affect 1 square kilometer of ground. 1 square kilometer, that's, I don't know how big that is, but it's kind of big, right? I want to get in there and there are enemy soldiers, I want to affect it so that I've done some, you know, I've dealt some punishment to the enemy. What's that going to cost? Conventional weapons, that's bullets, bombs, arrows, spears, about $2,000, you know, tanks, bullets. All. Nuclear, cheaper, about $800 to affect that area. Chemical, about the same, $600. Biological, if you look at the numbers theoretically, it costs me about $1. Now, obviously, I have to know what I'm doing and prepare and all that, but you start off with a little bit of organism, you grow them up, you weaponize them, so theoretically, it's the cheapest strategic or tactical weapon to deliver. That's why it's called a poor man's atomic bomb. If you don't have a lot of money, you know any countries that are hostile that don't have a lot of money? We got lots of money, we can do whatever we want. It's also called the lazy man's atomic bomb. What does that mean? Nuclear weaponry is very sophisticated. Levels of expertise and knowledge and technology. Chemical weapons actually require a lot of know-how and, you know, wherewithal. Biological, all you got to do, you know, like science fair, right? You did a science fair project on microbiology, probably that. You know, I'm simplifying it a little bit, but that's kind of what it's like. So it's called the lazy man's atomic bomb and the poor man's atomic bomb. Conventional nuclear and chemical weapons discharge has a finite effect. I mean, you know, there is a radioactive cloud. There's, you know, you injure people and they die later on. And same with a chemical. But they don't reproduce. Finite effect, biological, theoretically, can have an ongoing effect. And I'll give you an example that will stun you. Biological weapons discharge, potentially ongoing. They replicate. So what does the history of biological warfare teach? And there is a history. It goes way back. People have been doing this, using biological weapons for a long time. Military endeavors and epidemics are all kinds of things. I'm going to talk about some of them. Epidemics probably that have been caused because somebody used a biological weapon, meaning only to affect the bad guys, and it got out of hand, right?
Smallpox.
Smallpox, good example. Conquistadors inadvertently brought with them organisms that had decimated a good part of South America. They didn't know what they were doing, but it worked. Now, measles and smallpox. The measles, in our history with the white man's history in terms of conquering Native American tribes, mm-hmm. You know, they would use measles-affected blankets and individuals, and they knew what they were doing. They would introduce infected materials into a tribe or a culture or something that would take hold and people would get harmed. In the French American War. Anyway, the British used biological warfare. You know, there were the tribes that were sympathetic to the French. Then there were the tribes that were sympathetic to the British, and they used them against each other. Right. Well, Captain Usier, on the command of General, can't remember his name, the British general, gathered up carefully the blankets from the smallpox victims in the hospital and distributed them to the enemy Indian tribes. Mm-hmm. So smallpox was in the British and French population, but they had a partial resistance. The Indians had none. So this happened in the French. What is that stupid war?
It's the French and Indian wars, right?
And the civilized British, used biological warfare by smallpox sort of infested blankets, mm-hmm. and what happened was, yeah, the enemy Indians fighting against them were affected and people died. Did it get out of hand? No kidding, it got out of hand. It spread everywhere. It didn't matter which Native American tribe you were with, or which side you were on, or whether you were peaceful or argumentative, it just took off and got way out of hand. Mm-hmm. frightening historical bug. Do you think it's possible that the plague, the famous plague that started in 1347 and killed a third of Europe, do you think it's possible that it started as an act of biological warfare gone wrong? That's what some historians will tell you, and I'll talk about that in a bit. Plague transmission and vectors. Plague, that was the Great Plague, right? You have the mice, you have the rats, you have people, and you have lack of knowledge, and you have crowding conditions. Spread all over Europe. We know about Europe, and it killed a fourth to a third of the people. Was the plague in Africa? Yeah. Do we know what happened? No. Do we assume it did a lot of damage? Yeah. Was it in Asia? Yeah. Did it do a lot of damage? Yeah. We don't have all the records. We know all about Europe. It was global.
And it still exists. I mean, Sierra Nevada's, they had closed down a national forest because squirrels had plague.
Right, but it's sporadic endemic.
Uh-huh.
Sporadic and endemic, you know, like, boom, pops up here, but you're right, and prairie dogs.
Uh-huh.
Be careful about the prairie dogs.
Yeah.
So, in the 14th century, 1347, in Kaffa, over there by the Crimea, the guys from the north were coming down, they wanted to conquer Kaffa, it had a lot of Genoans in it, Italians, and it was a wealthy city, and it was kind of a trade city, but it was walled. So what did the commander do? He took some plague victims, and he stuck them in his catapult. And he catapulted them over the wall of Kaffa into the city,
oh my goodness,
with the fleas and everything, and then there were rats and fleas everywhere, so catapulted some dead plague bodies in there. Pretty soon, they got plague in Kaffa, right? So everybody freaked out, and the Genoans and the Italians that were there and the trading people said, oh, get the hell out of here. So they got on a ship, and where'd they go? They went over to Italy, which is right across the strait. And so if you follow, the timing is correct. The documentation of using these plague-infected bodies is correct. And then you look at the timing, and then you can track the ships that went. Then you say, where did the plague start? Well, it started right here. And then it moved north into Italy, and then it spread to Europe. So, can you prove it? No, but it's likely that the Great Plague epidemic was initially an episode of biological warfare meant just to affect this one walled city, make it easier to take over the city, to go in and loot and plunder. Pretty much got out of hand, didn't it? So they escaped to Messina, Italy. People are leaving. Well, there are mosquitoes, there are fleas and rats on the ship, and some people that maybe are early sick. They go to Messina, and it went across the strait to Italy. It moved. The speed initially of the plague was about 7 miles per day. It moved north up to into Italy. And then by 1348, it was in Italy, France, Spain, North Africa. 49, Switzerland, England, Hungary, Austria, Germany. 1350, Scandinavia, Baltics, rest of the world, the Great Plague Pandemic. Pandemic means not just Kaffa, not just Italy, not just Europe, the whole world. Because this one guy catapulted maybe, probably, plague victims over the wall of this one city. So, unintended consequences. So, biological warfare, and you read different places, you go, no, nobody will ever do it, it doesn't work. It works, and history teaches us that it can be devastating. So we want to pay attention. So, a third to half of Europe killed, what about Asia, Africa, we don't know. Social consequences were enormous. The ruling classes, right? Ruling classes had all kinds of people that would work for them, and they were really in charge. The social fabric, the beginning of the downfall of the ruling classes, I mean, if you look at the social scientists and what they write, so let's say you're a common laborer, right? And you're in 1348. Well, you're working for all the, and you don't have any, you can't do anything. There are tons of you, right? You're not educated, you don't have influence, you don't belong to some family. All the wealthy, rich people are in charge. And you don't do exactly what they say, they'll get somebody else. Well, what if a bunch of you die? Then there are not very many of you left to do the work on the estates and stuff. You have more power.
Yeah.
You say, hang on, buddy. Why don't you treat me a little better? Because I'm the only guy that can fix you or whatever. So the social consequences were enormous.
Did it ever affect the ruling classes?
Oh, sure. Everybody was affected.
Everybody.
Everybody was affected. But it mainly affected the crowding. crowding makes it more likely you're going to get infected. Mm-hmm. That the people didn't have anything, they're all crowded together, right? Mm-hmm. The ruling class is, you know, one per 50 rooms, and, you know. So you can read all these. I didn't bring the quotes because we've got a lot of slides, but read Petrarch and what he talks about. Because there are plagues that we think were like bubonic plagues that go out through history, and they talk about the devastating effects of these plagues. Peloponnesian Wars, big part of deciding the result of this war was the plague that happened. Rufus of Ephesus, description of the plague. These are brutal descriptions when you read about these people who were there at the time. 1361, Michel de Piazza wrote this text and read, pull some of these things up and look at it. Guy de Chauillac, Avignon Plague, 1348. He describes it in detail about the people and what was happening, what it was like to be there. They're stunning. So what do we learn about biowarfare? Cheap, easy, relatively easy, cheap, unforeseen consequences, right? Be careful, unforeseen consequences. And then I just told you about that. Yeah, there we are, French and Indian Wars, 18th century. The British, of all people. It was General, I forget his name, who told his Captain Ussher, he said, you go out there, collect these blankets, we'll fix those Indians that are fighting against us. Mm. 19th century development of microbiology. Now, even though we've used biological weapons throughout history, now we get really sophisticated because Louis Pasteur and Robert Koch and all these guys tell us how we can grow and work with microbiology. So now we can get really sophisticated related to biological warfare. So plague epidemic in London, you know, bring out your dead, that whole thing, horrible. Horrible social consequences, people scared to death of everything, right? And some of the descriptions I talked to you about before from some of these people who wrote descriptions. So let's, you know, your family's dying, your friends are dying, your neighbors are dying, everybody's scared, witless. I don't want to get near you, you don't want to get near me. So your mother dies, priest won't come. Doctor won't come. I mean, yeah, there are examples of people who were selfless and went out and, you know, she's a good Catholic lady, she's not getting a priest. I mean, you know, in fact, nobody's getting near her body. And, you know, all this kind of stuff, a lot of suffering because of the fear factor. So, terrifically devastating. Running around, picking up dead bodies and throwing them on the fire piles. You think this is a great job? This is not a great job, right? So, let's talk a little bit about plague. Because if you look at an organism, let's say I wanted to have a biological warfare capability in my little country. Well, plague would be one that I would put in there because we know a lot about it, it's easy to use, and you can figure out different ways to weaponize it and use it. So it's an automatic on your list, and so a lot of countries have worked with plague. Fatal plague, septicemia, Yersinia pestis, gram-negative organism. And it can either come in orally or respiratory-wise, and it's a devastating disease. If you get enough of a load in terms of respiratory, you can be dead within a matter of hours or days. So, and it's easily transmissible. And I don't want to dwell too much on all these pictures, but let's talk some more about modern history. We talked about ancient history, modern history, World War I. Did you know that the Germans actually were on U.S. soil trying to put different fungi and feedstuffs for animals and trying to use some chemical weapons? They didn't do it very effectively. It didn't work very well. But, you know, World War I, the early part of World War I, donkeys, horses, that's really important. That's how you, so poison the foodstuff of the Americans' mules and horses. So they tried to contaminate foodstuffs. So after World War I, in the Geneva Treaty, they actually tried to talk about chemical weapons and biological weapons, say this is a bad idea. World War II, the Japanese. Here's Unit 731. This is a horrible story. The Japanese launched in the 30s into a very extensive, highly developed biological warfare research capacity in occupied Manchuria. You know, they took over Manchuria in the 30s. And then they took this area of Manchuria and they put soldiers around it. And then, so they had captive population in these little towns, and they experimented on those peoples, those Chinese. And it was called Unit 731. This is a great book to read if you want to read it. It had 731 had 150 buildings. That's a lot of buildings. Are there even 150 buildings in Rock Springs? I mean, it had 300 personnel, basic personnel, not support personnel, but, you know, science people and technicians and stuff. Chinese deaths resulting from these biological experiments, not nuclear, not bullets, not chemical, purely biological experiments in the tens of thousands. Japanese killed tens of thousands of Chinese in occupied Manchuria by experimenting on them. And they used plague, cholera, Shigella, and anthrax. Those were the big ones that they were experimenting with. They used food and water contamination. So they'd come in, and there would be a town, this little town. And they'd say, okay, here's what we're going to do. Don't tell anybody. And these people couldn't leave because they had Japanese soldiers around. So they'd sneak some stuff into the water. And then they'd go around taking notes. Oh, look, two dead babies over here, a sick lady over here, and taking notes and observing what happened. Then they do some autopsies. No treatment. They just were seeing how this works. It was all research. So a lot of spraying, a lot of water and food contamination, see what happened. They took plague-infected fleas, 150 million of them, and released them overhead of a village area. And then they recorded what happened. Oh, this many people got sick, this many people died, this is how soon it took to happen. Research on how to use this stuff more effectively. Now, the field trials were stopped by the Japanese. They started in the 30s. The Japanese High Command said, okay, we're not doing this anymore. In 1942, they stopped them. Do you know why? Because unforeseen consequences. Their own soldiers and technicians were dying because they didn't have enough safety checks in place, and they go, oh, God. We got to stop this. We can't do it properly, so let's just not do it anymore. Unforeseen consequences. So this is the book, Factories of Death. This was only declassified, 20 years ago. It was all hush-hush and secret, and I'll tell you why. Factories of Death, Japanese Biological Warfare, 1932 to 1945, and the American Cover-Up by Sheldon Harris. It's a spectacular book. So here's Unit 731 from the air. Look, this is way up. This is 6,000 feet up. Look at all these buildings. This is huge. All biological warfare research by the Japanese, right there in occupied Manchuria. All of it biological research in the 30s and early 40s. Okay. Now, I'm going to show you what's the biggest, now I'm prejudiced, but what's the biggest research single unit medical research entity in the world? The NIH, where I come from, right? In Bethesda, Maryland. It's big. Let me show you what the NIH looked like when I was there, which is not that long ago. Whoops, wait a minute. Oh, it's not in there. All right, well, I put a picture in there. Anyway, it's maybe a third of this thing. It's today, modern times, the biggest, hugest medical research thing. I'm doing all kinds of things. This was all biological, and it dwarfed the size. So here we have a picture of, he's all gowned up, this Japanese technician, collecting samples from a dead Manchurian after the experiments, right? And here's a dead child going to autopsy. Here's Colonel Ishii. He was a microbiologist, a smart guy. He was the head of the whole thing. He designed all these research things. He put them in place. And I want you to know he was a good family man. He loved his wife, and he loved his mother, and he took good care of his kids. You know how they talk about Hitler loved children, that kind of stuff.
Always paid his rent on time.
This is Colonel Leach.
Yeah.
Huh? Always paid his rent on time.
Pretty much, yeah. So, there he is. And Kitano Misaji was the senior military person working with Ishiro because they needed military presence, because once the Chinese figured out some of this wasn't good, they wouldn't want to get out of there. They weren't allowed to get out of there. So to keep control, they had a military contingent. Wow. Now, let me see. Okay, so what happened to Colonel Ishii? Now, they got him after the war, right? Remember the Nuremberg World Trials, Japanese, German, some Italian, everything. Ishii just kind of disappeared. Mm-hmm. Never convicted, never sentenced, never anything. And this is a plus minus, but you know where he went? We took him. The United States took possession of him, and he worked for us for the next number of years. Not in a bad way, like we want to be able to go out and do this to people, because we're not like that. Mm-hmm. And we never have been. But everybody was scared. They're like, oh my God, we have to learn as much as we can to help defend. So it was a practical decision. Instead of being convicted for war crimes, he went to work for the Americans in a very secret capacity. And we were able to learn a lot about biological warfare. Mm-hmm. So anyway, so a recurring theme. Effective? Yep. Difficult to control? Yep. Look what happened with the plague, if that's indeed what it was. Look what happened with Unit 731, the Japanese soldiers started dying. Look what happened in the French and Indian Wars. Mm. Nazis in World War II, they did a little bit, but not a lot of biological. They took some sewage in Bohemia and tried to, you know, contaminate water supplies, but they didn't do a lot. Do you know why the Nazis didn't use chemical weapons or biological weapons much? They wanted to develop a nuclear weapon. Do you know why? Because Hitler had been gassed in World War I with mustard gas. He didn't like it. And he wasn't going to have anything to do with chemical weapons or biological weapons, because he'd experienced it. He said, it's bad news, and we're not doing it.
That's one reason he kept his mustache like that, so the gas mask is sealed. That's what I heard.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Wow, that's fascinating.
He was scared.
Do you want to hear that? Because that's an ugly mustache. So, in World War II, we in fact did have anthrax bombs. We weaponized anthrax, and the, you know, who knows what the deal was, but the intention was they were never to be used unless somebody used them on us. But we did have them. We got rid of them. So what was the modern situation after World War II? So, in 1942, we started to develop in War Reserve Service, Camp Dietrich, Maryland, and Mississippi and in Utah, some different camps to study biological weaponry, because other people were using it, and we have to find out about it. Ishii was involved. Camp Dietrich is still there, and that's still where we do our biological warfare research and so forth. Production proof. And so what happened? Unforeseen consequences. In Indiana facility, leakage. We had production problems. That's scary, right? World War II arsenal. We only had 5,000 anthrax bombs. They were located, or they were developed at Fort Detrick. And Misaji and Ishii got immunity from the war crimes trial because we needed their expertise. The Korean area, we expanded our capabilities by a new facility at Pine Bluff, Arkansas. And then in 19, things really began to ramp up because we were worried about the Soviet bloc, right? In 1950 to 71, there was a lot of animal experimentation. 1955 to 1971, a lot of human experimentation. Mm-hmm. This will really shock you. Human beings, naive, didn't know about it, humans, not just like volunteers or like prisoners or whatever. People just that didn't know that this was happening. Mm-hmm. And the eight ball, another definition is in Fort Detrick, Maryland, was a giant metal ball that was airtight and super safe. And you could go in there, you could put volunteers and stuff in there, and you could release a biologic agent and see what happened. You know? Overhead spraying, this will get you. At this time frame, in the United States cities, specifically New York and San Francisco, secretly the military sprayed simulants. Remember the simulant thing? It's not going to hurt anybody. Serratia marcescens, the gram-negative bacteria, was used as a simulant for plague. So we actually would go over a city and release some serratia and aerosol, and then the guys would go take samples here and there and check and see what was going on. They weren't looking for disease at all, because they said, well, it's not going to hurt anybody, but we want to see if we can culture it here and culture it there and culture it there. So what happened? When we did that. We did that. It's very secret. What happened was these reports at a San Francisco General Hospital started to emerge. And the doctors are talking, they're all like, wow, I get a case of serratia pneumonia over here. I haven't seen one of those in years. Isn't that fascinating? He goes, I have one across the street. That's amazing. Ooh, I get a case of serratia sepsis. isn't that interesting? The doctors start talking. The military heard this and they're like, crap, right? So there were some discussions, high level secret discussions, where the civilian academic community got together secretly with the military and the government, and they said, don't do this. Just look what's happened. You can't do this no more. And they said, swear to God, cross my heart, hope to die. Won't do it anymore. It continued on for a number of years, in different formats. It's done and gone. But that's kind of what happened. Public populations, San Francisco, New York. I mean, today that's just stunned us. And it was all declassified not very long ago. Serratia outbreaks, 1950-51. It's in the literature. And we know now that serratia can cause bad stuff. At the time, we didn't know. We thought serratia was a benign organism. We thought Bacillus subtilis was a relatively benign organism. Government panel recommendations, you know. Public Senate hearing, 1977. And then public hearing, people heard this and they said, are you kidding me? Then things really started to heat up. Minneapolis smokescreen test, 1966. Bacillus subtilis, a simulant, presumably benign and non-threatening, released in a U.S. subway system to see what would happen. Where could they culture it and so forth. 1998. The British government admitted to spraying E. coli over some population areas, but that not in 1998, but years and years before. So in the late 60s, we had a U.S. biological biowarfare arsenal, defensive and offensive. And there's a very interesting concept of humane biological warfare development. And let me just say, you know, you can kill people with plague and you can kill people with anthrax and smallpox, right? But there's also, we were the only ones to do it. The Russians didn't care, I shouldn't say that. But we wanted to do something humane. So if you think about it, if you need to invade country X, and they've got soldiers and tanks and everything else, if we were to fly over there or send a missile over there and or a bomb and they had like a flu virus in it, it's not going to kill everybody. Or a cold virus, but it's going to make 50% or 75 or 80% of those people sick as a dog for 3 days. It's a perfect opportunity for you to move your forces in. I don't care if he's a Marine or a Special Forces guy. If he's got the bad flu and he's sick as a dog, he ain't what he used to be, right? You move in, you take over, the guys wake up, they're better. So that's the thought of humane biological warfare. And you could theoretically do the same thing with other mechanisms. So there was research on that. Using the, you know, they studied the wind currents and stuff. We release it here, weaponized so it doesn't get, you know, messed up by the sunlight, and it arrives over this area within a certain period of time. We give it 48 hours, they're going to be sick, we move in, and there's no resistance. So Johnston Atoll naval exercises. This was stunning. Johnston Atoll is a group of islands in the Pacific Ocean. In the 60s, we did a ton of research. We had all these, we had Navy ships out there and all kinds of biological things. We'd spray stuff and we'd do bombs and all kinds of things. And we'd have barges set up with animals and petri dishes and all kinds of stuff. We did these huge, huge experimentations. And we found out all this stuff about how lethal and how effective biological warfare was. So then the military and senior government went to the administration, which was Nixon at the time, and they said, whoa, Mr. President, we got the results of all this stuff, look at this. Scared the bejesus out of him and everybody else. They said, this is terrible. This is too terrible. We need to get to work with the rest of the world and we need to get rid of all this stuff. Mm-hmm. So that's when they began to work on the treaty, right? That 1969 started, and of course at the time it was Brezhnev, so we got with the Russians, we said, this is horrible stuff, we'll show you some of our data. We all need to get together and say, we're not doing it, we'll destroy our stockpiles. And the Russians said, yeah, great idea, that's good. Well, Brezhnev didn't trust Nixon, or the Americans. So what that did, they had some research going on, what that did when they created the treaty was he thought Nixon and the U.S. government was doing this as a ploy to get the Russians to burn up all their stuff. They launched into a secret, super expansive biological warfare development program while saying, yep, we destroyed it all, and they let them visit some sites showing that, oh, this was a big lie. We did not lie. We actually destroyed our stuff. We got rid of it. But the Russians, launch it, and it's a big deal we didn't find out about until years later. So 80 kilogram weapon, 50 mile fly line, hot zone, all kinds of details about the kinds of weapons we could develop and what we could do with them. The White House, November 25, 1969, President Nixon, he called it germ warfare. He gave this talk, you can pull up the talk, saying, this is too scary, it's bad news, we gotta get rid of it. Brezhnev's response was to jump all over the treaty, say great, but there was deceit. In 1972, the treaty was authorized by the Soviets, 73. Now remember, as they're launching on a big, sophisticated research program of biological warfare, unbeknownst to us because it was super secret, we're developing even more sophistication. We insert a gene into E. coli in 1970. So we can now take weapons and bugs that are already bad and make them badder, right? So things are really getting scary here. 1979, remember this? Sverdlovsk? There were some people that died of anthrax, 66 in Sverdlovsk, Soviet Union. And the Russians and everybody overseas, like the Americans and Brits, always said, hey, are you kidding? 66 people died of anthrax? This wasn't just sporadic. Are you messing around? Are you not following the treaty? No, 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 it was fine. They said, no, it was a sheep, and their animals can have anthrax. No, it was some sheep and some wool, and the spores got in the air, and they lied about that. Mm-hmm. It was a leak from one of their anthrax research facilities that killed those people. They couldn't hide it.
So they weaponized it to be airborne.
Totally. Then, 1989, this guy defects, and he comes over and talks to us, and he tells us and the Brits this fairy tale story of how the Soviets were developing huge bioreactors, developed all kinds of biological weapons. We didn't believe him initially. We're like, are you for real? Are you a double agent? Whatever. Told this horrible story, but started looking into it. So, anthrax, I'm just going to flip through these, because what time is it?
It's one.
We need to move on. Anyway, what happened is, Sverdlovsk, in this biological thing, their filters weren't efficient enough, and the stuff got out.
Oh, wow.
But they had, once we've, this is when the Soviet Union is starting to go broke, right? Starting to fall apart, right?
Yeah.
So Bush and Thatcher pressured Gorbachev. First inspection was allowed in December 1990, because we were getting the idea that something was going on. And we were allowed to inspect, and what they saw was stunning. Huge facilities, all kinds of stuff that the Russians or the Soviets were working on. They had intercontinental ballistic missiles with bio-warheads. Just like, you know, there are nuclear missiles. Mm-hmm. Well, they're missiles that the Soviets developed, intercontinental, filled with bio. So they come, they land, they blow up, and suddenly you've got anthrax spores all over the place. And we had destroyed everything. We didn't have anything other than defensive measures, like vaccines and treatments and things like that. So Vladimir the defector, you know, from 10, 15 years before, he was absolutely right. 52 biowarfare facilities across the USSR. 52 facilities. And they were spread out so that people wouldn't. Institute of Applied Microbiology in Obelinsk had 30 buildings. And this was supposedly a microbiology thing. Secretly, it was biological warfare. Mm. Well protected. They were weaponizing plague. And they had a level 4 facility, which is the tightest and the fanciest, 40 biofermenter tanks. You know, you grow up bacteria, it's like growing beer, you put them in tanks. Well, these tanks, you know, in a microbiology lab, I've done lots of microbiology research. I mean, you have little things like this, These were like room filling, growing up massive amounts of all kinds of nasty things. At the Kotsovo Institute, they were working on hemorrhagic, like Ebola is a hemorrhagic fever, and they were working on smallpox. Now, actually, I was on the state thing, so I got my vaccine like 10 years ago. I mean, it's a new vaccine, so it's good. But everybody else vaccinated for smallpox. The old smallpox immunity was about 10 years, they think. So nobody was really protected. And this quote, this quote was, Preston is one of our big emerging infectious disease experts, and his quote is like, you wouldn't believe how terrible this was. Kotsovo staff in 1991, when they figured it all out and broke it all down, it was about 4,000. 1998, once the Soviet Union was falling apart and they got rid of it, 2,000, half as many. Where do you think all those people went? They lost their day job. They had a skill set. What was their skill set? Making biological weapons.
We got them.
We may have some of them, but some of them are known to go to the Mideast and other places. Mm. Iraq had an extensive biological weapons program before we got in there, right? Mm. They had Clostridia, anthrax, cholera, aflatoxin, botulism, wheat rust, camel pox. In response to all this, we stocked about 30 million doses of Cipro. Our troops are vaccinated with anthrax. Mm. And where do you think Iraq, before all the excitement, got their original cholera and anthrax cultures? They just ordered them through a U.S. biological supply house in the mail, which is what you could do in those days. If I put in an order now and I tried to order something, you know, about half an hour later there'd be a knock on my door and these guys in suits with like badges. Are you Chris Brown? Come with me, you know. So anyway, last smallpox case, 1977. Smallpox is an interesting history, but I don't want to. Mm. So, how are the Iraqis going to deliver? In the Scud missiles and in bombs. They had it all set up. Government versus small group biowarfare and nuclear, chemical, biological. Have we ever seen, we've had biological warfare here in this country. In 1994, this kind of odd guru-based semi-religious group that had their own little compound in Oregon put salmonella in the salad bars. Because there was a vote. The people in the community are like, you guys are weird, we're not gonna approve your new building permit. And we're gonna go vote about it. So they put salmonella salad bars all over town, thinking if we make enough of them sick, they won't show up to vote. We from the community will vote and we'll be able to build our new stuff. It was all figured out. So biological warfare has happened on our turf. Huh? So 1995, sarin gas attack, Tokyo subway. This is an Ishinru crazy fanatic group, they figured out. Am Shinriko cult. They were working, when they caught them, this was a gas attack. They blew it and the Japanese figured it all out. They were working in their little, not very sophisticated lab on anthrax and botulism. Mm. This little bitty cult of Japanese, they didn't have very much money, didn't have very much sophistication, they didn't have a guy like me that knew all about microbiology, they just read a couple of microtexts and stuff, and they were working with botulism and anthrax. We're going to do that next. And they had a radio-controlled drone aircraft that they were working on, so they could put this stuff in their sprayer and fly it around Tokyo. Squirt, squirt, you know. And then they had also, members of their group had taken a trip to Zaire in 1992 to try to collect Ebola. This crazy, radical Japanese group. Mm. So, if they hadn't been found out, could they have done stuff? Sure, they could have done amazing stuff. So, today's bugs and today's arsenals, we'll talk about that a little bit. And the military, let's just skip this here. So, short list of traditional desirable weapons. Don't you love the way they say desirable? If you're a country, you want that. These are the ones you want. You want anthrax, tularemia, brucellosis, plague, Q fever. And these are encephalitis virus and viral hemorrhagic. This is like Ebola. Mm. And smallpox. Smallpox is the only one classed as an irrational agent. Is that crazy? That means it's irrational to use it because it's going to come back and bite you. Mm-hmm. Mm. Because nobody's immune anymore and smallpox went away a long time ago. So you release it, you may send it all over the world. Mm. So why would we use it, right? Some of these, more limited effect, maybe you can keep it under control. And there's no treatment for this, right? You can vaccinate your, well, you can vaccinate your people, but. So, now new additions to the traditional list. Rice blast, it's a fungus. You spray it on these crops, and they get little spots, and it kills all the rice. Now look at China, you know? I mean, a lot of people are very dependent upon rice, but you can destroy their rice crop. So that's a newer one. Rinderpest, measles-like virus, and it kills and damages your buffaloes, goats, cattle, and giraffes, if you happen to be eating giraffes. And it's long been known as a cattle plague. So if you go into a country that depends a lot on meat and goats and stuff, you can just wipe out their food supply. Botulism, tinnitus. I put this has been around a long time. I say new additions because now there's more sophistication. You can grow up lots of it. Before it was hard to get a lot of it, right? It's highly toxic and it's very concentrated. Now they have ways to make a lot more. So it's kind of new interest to people that want to do biological warfare. Nipah virus. So in Malaysia, it's relatively new. 1999, it killed half the people it infected. 50% mortality. They don't know how it's transmitted, so why would you mess with it? high mutation rate, meaning it's going to be hard to make a vaccine, so people are interested in Nipah virus, you know, to dump on other people. Chimera viruses, this is scary. Remember I talked about genetic manipulation? We can modify genes. We can make a lot of stuff, can't we? Chimera viruses, meaning in the late 80s, the Soviets had a chimera project as part of their deal. And their primary initiative was to combine Ebola and smallpox. Come on. Anyway, presumably that's gone by the wayside. So, aerosol delivery, that's a good way to deliver most biological weapons. And it can be modified. A lot of organisms are killed by sunlight. You can weaponize them, protect them, coat them. So you can still aerosolize them, protect them from sunlight when they land, they do their thing. And the most likely threat, if you really want to say a country who's going to deliver a weapon, most likely threat, the one they know the most about, the easiest to deliver, would probably be anthrax. Okay. Probably be anthrax. Easier production, delivery, and lethality. So I'm going to zoom by all this. So all you have to do is inhale 5,000 spores, that's nothing. And that means it's got an LD50. That means 5,000 spores, that's nothing.
Mm-hmm. You can fit a million of them on the tip of a pin.
Yeah. So you inhale, so an LD50, that means half the people who inhale that are going to be dead. That's an LD50. Okay? So, well, 10,000 spores, that's nothing. But maybe it'll kill them off. So a typical bioterrorist anthrax weapon would be about 10 to 13 power spores per kilo. Bomb spread spores in 1 billion liters of air. So the bomb would go off, and it's already been developed, people know. And it would spread out into 1 billion liters of air. Final concentration would be 10,000 spores per liter per air. You're going to breathe that in, aren't you? Probably more than that. Normal adult inhales a lethal dose of spores within a few seconds. Silent incubation period, time for escape. There is an incubation period. If you're the bad guy, you've got a number of hours to get out of town, right? A day or two before people start. Effective treatment required before symptoms. If you're going to treat these people, you really need to get to them before they develop symptoms. Well, it's already been done. You're not going to do that, right? Majority of killing occurs within 72 hours. That's the modern anthrax weapon. Okay. The future superbugs, gene engineering. You know, we can do everything with genetic engineering, right? So, detection and prevention. Well, it's hard to assess, but the U.S. government has spent a lot of money on, you know, we've been involved with some of that here, on detection. There are all kinds of fancy detectors and everything, but suffice it to say, a lot of that's government and military and so forth. There's a mask. There are soldiers with a mask. Anthrax, I'm just going to zoom by because we're already over time here. You can treat it. But you have to treat it early, which is almost impossible if you're doing inhalation. It's too late. These are all the recommended things. And this is, remember the war, anthrax scare?
Uh-huh.
People are all in the mail rooms and so forth. Smallpox,
okay.
Bad actor, right? Now, let's talk about today, and then we'll finish. So today, weapons of mass destruction breakdown for biological warfare. I didn't put nuclear and chemical here, but right now today, now I separated these countries. Do these look like pretty friendly countries? Yeah, France, India, Israel, Saudi Arabia, South Africa, South Korea, Taiwan, UK, United States, Vietnam. These are kind of friendly people. One of them is known to have, probably. When you say who's got it and who doesn't, there's nobody's admitting to it.
Mm.
So, but when the people look and they say, yeah, the Israelis' presumption is they have some capability.
Mm.
1 out of 9% of all these people, you see any guys in here that look unfriendly?
Yes.
Yeah, 50% of these countries probably are involved and have stockpiles and have capabilities. So if this was one big list, and I divided it up, a little bit politically incorrect, but the point is that some of the countries that are antagonistic to are very interested, and North Korea clearly, Russia clearly, Syria. I mean, really, Syria has a budget to work on this. Syria should be feeding its people and building schools and stuff. Algeria? Are you kidding? You know, Iraq, it was there, but it was gone, right? And Libya was there, and it was gone. So it's an interesting makeup. And so in conclusion, it's effective. Remember Kaffa, maybe the big plague, the Johnson Atolls, cheapest and easiest to make and hide. So you can be a little terrorist group of 5-10 people. You don't even know much, right? This would be your best bet if you really want to create havoc. Pick biological weapons. You're not going to pick chemical and nuclear. You want to know how to do it, right? Yeah. Strategic weapon, problem for everybody. Terrorism in small groups, poor man's atomic bomb. Hard to control. Look what happened, if this is what happened. Look at the French and Indian wars. Aggressive, globally coordinated response required. All these governments have to get together and they have to say, look, we take this seriously. Let's all get on the same page. And be aware, be informed, and be quick. That's it. This is a, you know, some of the, this is a plastic baby, you know, this is one of these. This was in Tokyo, I believe, after that thing, and the Japanese were ramping up to make sure that they were equipped to handle everything. Mm. Any questions?
Is there any work forward to stop these countries from using this? Or?
Well, the old treaty is still in force, but it's not a regular treaty, so they keep reworking it and reworking it. And governments talk to each other, obviously, and we have destroyed all our stockpiles as a result of Nixon's initiative, supposedly, and I believe that. But we have a lot of we do a lot of research on defensive. How do we do that? And then you, geopolitical stuff. You go to these countries and you say, oh, there was one thing in there that said the presumed reason why the Iraqis during the two wars didn't use biological weapons. You know, who knows? But one of the stories, did you turn that off?
I will.